Waters World is on tonight. Some of the biggest names in Washington all here. Kellyanne Conway, Sean Spicer, and Senator Ted Cruz dare to enter Waters World. Plus, I hit the streets in search of illegal immigrants.
Did you come here legally or illegally?
Illegal.
Illegal?
Yeah.
Was it difficult to cross the border?
No.
And one college honoring White Privilege Month. But what does that actually mean?
So you're not white?
I am Italian. I'm American.
So isn't it more determinative to be have American privilege than have white privilege?
Waters World begins right now.
Welcome to Waters World from DC. I'm Jesse Waters. Fake news media thought they had President Trump on the ropes in January. The administration was in chaos, leaks everywhere, and a so-called Russian scandal was brewing. Until the commander-in-chief called a press conference, stuffed the media in a locker, then flew down to Florida to spike the football, and then doubled down at CPAC.
We are fighting the fake news. It's fake, phony, fake. A few days ago, I called the fake news the enemy of the people, and they are. They have no sources. They just make them up when there are none. The dishonest media did not explain that I called the fake news the enemy of the people, the fake news. They dropped off the word fake. And all of a sudden, the story became the media is the enemy. They take the word fake out. So I'm not against the media. I'm not against the press. I don't mind bad stories if I deserve them. But I am only against the fake news media or press. They shouldn't be allowed to use sources unless they use somebody's name. Let their name be put out there. A source says that Donald Trump is a horrible, horrible human being. Let him say it to my face. I love the First Amendment. Nobody loves it better than me. But the First Amendment gives all of us, it gives it to me, it gives it to you, it gives it to all Americans, the right to speak our minds freely. It gives you the right and me the right to criticize fake news.
So this is throwing the press into a complete tailspin. Here's Mika Brzezinski of NBC News.
He's trying to undermine the media, trying to make up his own facts. And it could be that while unemployment and the economy worsens, he could have undermined the messaging so much that he can actually control exactly what people think. And that is our job.
Did you hear that? Mika just revealed how the press views the public. People incapable of forming their own opinions. Instead of the Fox News motto, we report, you decide, the fake news media motto is, we control what you think. That's because the media does not trust average Americans. If they did, they wouldn't have to lie. But once again, the media realized that fake news could not stop Donald Trump, so they kicked it up a notch. Fake quotes. Here is Urban Radio White House correspondent April Ryan.
Did he also visit slavery? And the reason why I'm asking this is because when he was candidate Trump, he said things like, you know, we made this country, meaning white America, not necessarily black. Did he gain?
I don't know why you would say that. What do you mean?
No. He said that. I heard him say that.
Don't you think if Donald Trump actually said white America built this country, we all would have heard that before? That's because he didn't. Here's what he actually said.
We're people that have built this country and made this country great. And we're all together. And we want to get along with everybody.
So here you have the media straight up concocting fake racist Trump quotes. But it gets worse. Pundits, incapable of grasping Donald Trump's mass appeal, resort to lazy smears because it's the last card they have left to play.
When he said today, America first, it was not just the racial, I mean, the Hitlerian background to it, but it was the message.
When he says that the media is the, quote,
enemy
of the people, where he sounds more like Mussolini or Lenin, which obviously causes concern, that phrase right there makes him sound more like a dictator in training.
NBC News hitting the trifecta. Congratulations, guys. Hitler, Mussolini, Lenin? Pathetic. Trump's been in office a month. These dictators killed millions of people. The only thing Trump has killed are regulations. But death is front and center on the minds of many journalists, predicting President Trump will incite violence and even homicide.
I'm worried because somebody who's deranged is going to hear this kind of language take action against a journalist, either at a rally or in some more private setting.
Somebody's going to get hurt. It's just a question of time, because just like in every other dynamic in life, if you take somebody who's got a legitimate reason to be upset in the first place and you pump them up and it starts to become a call to action, somebody's going to get hurt.
Now, the last time I checked, it was the Democrats causing violence after the election. Democrats rioting in Berkeley. And Black Lives Matter inspired maniacs shooting police officers in Dallas. So now we've reached the boy who cried wolf stage. The left-wing media cannot maintain this hysterical pace for 4 years. They're destroying whatever little credibility they had left when Trump undertakes action that deserves legitimate criticism. Nobody is going to listen to them anymore. That's what's actually dangerous, not Trump's quips on the stump. Here's how White House Chief Strategist Steve Bannon assessed the situation.
Just like they were dead wrong on the chaos of the campaign, and just like they were dead wrong in the chaos of the transition, they are absolutely dead wrong about what's going on today. They're corporatist, globalist media that are adamantly opposed to an economic nationalist agenda like Donald Trump has. And as economic conditions get better, as more jobs get better, they're going to continue to fight.
So, media warfare, where is this all headed? Here to discuss with me is Fox News contributor Richard Fowler and TheHill.com media reporter Joe Concha. So, Richard, you have White House correspondents making up fake Donald Trump quotes. You have to understand why the president's kind of angry with these people.
Well, here's the thing. I can't speak to where April Ryan got that quote from, but let's...
Well, she got it from nowhere because it wasn't true.
Well, fair, but let's talk about this for just a minute, right? So for the past 2 years, right, Donald Trump has run for president, and Donald Trump has said falsehoods. His White House has made things up, like the Bowling Green massacre or the terrorist attack in Sweden, and everything the president said...
Well,
He's saying
things are crazy in Sweden. Well, even you would have to admit that.
Even though the crime rate is lower in Sweden now than it was... before.
No, but the immigration crime rates through the roof.
Let me make my point here, right? The point I'm trying to make is this. He says these things. Everything the president says, we can all agree, is newsworthy, which is why the press follow him around, because everything he says makes news. So when the president puts out falsehoods, or his camp puts out falsehoods, like the Bowling Green massacre, that is false. And the synonym for false is fake. So that means this White House traffics in fake news. You can't criticize fake news if you traffic in it and you benefit from it.
So, Joe, what Richard seems to be saying to me is that because President Trump will sometimes exaggerate, that gives the mainstream media the right to create fake news and exaggerate as well. Is that how you think of this? I don't see it that way, Joe.
Well, let me address Richard first. Richard, why won't you denounce what April Ryan said? You said you can't speak to her, but why doesn't she get criticized by anybody in the media besides what we're doing right now on the show?
I don't know where she got the quote from.
Get it from anywhere.
And I think she should source the quote. But with that, wait a minute. This is less to do with April Ryan and more to do with what the president said at CPAC this week. This week, the president said at CPAC that these people need to release their names. People that are leaking information should release their names. This president has tweeted information that was leaked, and he said sources are saying, or people are saying, but journalists, a lot of times, and Joe can agree with me on this point, depend upon confidential sources to reveal information.
Richard, that's a pivot. I want to get back to Ryan for
a second. Richard said what he had to say, then go ahead, Joe.
Okay, great, thank you. So in these cases, here's the problem. April Ryan is wrong. She cannot produce a quote. She will not apologize. She will not retract. Her publication will not reprimand her in any capacity. And these mistakes will keep happening over and over again unless there is accountability and unless the media as a whole says, April Ryan, you're representing us poorly. You're allowing Donald Trump to use a broad brush to say everything is fake because of mistakes like that. Or earlier in the week when the Associated Press said that the president was going to deploy 100,000 National Guard troops to round up illegal aliens. When it wasn't sourced, it was completely wrong.
Right.
When this keeps happening, it gives the president the excuse to use that brush and say fake news all over the place, because we as a media are not calling out these people, whether it be Associated Press or April Ryan in these situations, for getting it wrong.
Right. And let me ask you this, because it's not just creating fake quotes. It's some of the commentary, and we played some of it at the top, Richard. When you have actual journalists on major networks saying that Trump is like Hitler or Mussolini or like Lenin, Do you think that's responsible journalism?
Well, here's the thing. The two clips that we saw, that I'm not saying journalists do or don't say this, but
was it responsible journalism?
Wait a minute. Let me make my point. Joe Scarborough is not a journalist. He is a Republican operative that has turned into a television host, and he could say whatever he wants to say. He's an operative.
Okay, so you would approve of a Fox News commentator calling President Obama Hitler?
Here's
you would think that's okay?
It was done before. It was done. Is
when?
It right? The point is that people say
wait a second. Wait a second, Richard. You said it was done.
Wait a minute.
You said it was done. What Fox News commentator called Obama Hitler?
The point I'm trying to make is this.
Well, you can't.
It is the job of us pundits. I am a pundit to make opinions, right? We come on, we say our opinion. If I never said Trump was, I never said that President Trump was Mussolini or Hitler or Stalin. I didn't say any of that.
Right.
But I think pundits can say that. They're given the liberty to do that.
It's a marketplace of ideas, and if you say crazy stuff, you can't really stay on the air. I'll give you the last word, Joe.
All right, Richard. There are five examples after the inauguration speech of journalists, reporters, including Terry Moran of ABC News, who referred to the president in Hitlerian terms, who called it dark, who went personal. And when you this is what last word means.
American death. That's what he said in his speech, Joe, just to be clear.
No, he said American carnage.
Carnage
you want the exact...
is death. Look it up in the dictionary.
Right. Well,
it's death. American death.
So
that's
that gives,
what it means.
Whoa. So that gives a reporter a right to call him Hitler?
Why would the president of the United States say that? Because it's not true.
He was talking about carnage like in Chicago, where there's over 2,000 killings.
The crime rate is actually lower now than it's ever been.
Wait a second, Richard. There was like seven people shot in Chicago the other day. Give me a break.
I'm not saying Chicago's not a bad situation.
The murder rate is up in Chicago. You know
what? The crime rate in the United States is down.
Richard, here's the point. Here's the point.
That's not true. Major cities across
the country. But it's down across the country.
Not in the major cities across the country, but we got to go, Richard. Thank you very much.
Here's the point.
Joe, we got to go.
All right, bye.
Up next, I talk with some illegal aliens in New York City. Did you come here legally or illegally?
Illegal.
Illegal?
Yeah.
Was it difficult to cross the border?
No.
Plus, White Privilege Month at college. Waters World investigates. President Trump announced new illegal immigration measures this week, and while many on the left are in an uproar over that, at least two dangerous illegal immigrant criminals have been allowed to walk free. In Denver, an illegal immigrant gang member was in jail. The feds tried to keep him there, but the sheriff's department let him go. And once he left, he allegedly killed a man. And just this week in New York City, another illegal immigrant gang member was allowed to walk out of prison after serving time and is now roaming the streets thanks to Bill de Blasio's sanctuary city policies. The man's actually an admitted member of the notorious MS-13 gang. And now we don't even know where he is. And he's not the only one. An incredible 1.2 million illegal immigrants live in New York City, more than any other place in the country. So Waters World traveled to the Bronx to talk to some illegal immigrants. Where are you from?
Mexico.
Dominican Republic.
De Santo Domingo, de Santiago.
Oh, Chile.
Dominican Republic.
Oh, Dominican Republic. Did you come here legally or illegally?
Illegal.
Illegal?
Yeah.
Illegal. Legal.
Todos somos ilegal, pero yo soy legal, yo soy residente.
Are you trying to become legal? Did you cross the border?
40 years ago.
40 years ago? How much did it cost to pay the coyote?
Hace 40 años, 600 pesos.
That's pretty expensive.
Okay.
How long have you been in America?
For now, 10 years.
29 years.
Did you cross the border into what state?
Arizona.
Was it difficult to cross the border?
No.
Do you respect immigration law?
Yes.
Un poco.
Nah.
What do you think we should do about illegal immigration?
Legalizarse.
Round them up and shut them out. They're taking all our jobs, and it's not fair.
What do you think America should do about illegal immigration?
Bueno, yo creo que hay que darle la oportunidad a todo.
Even if you break the law?
No.
If you are illegal and commit a crime, should you stay?
No.
They have to go back?
Yeah. I think everybody is coming for work.
If you come in illegally, then you have to go back.
Get them out?
Yeah, you have to go back.
So do you think anybody should be able to come to this country?
I mean, as long as their paperwork is good.
Even if you're an illegal immigrant, America should help you out?
Yes, because we all humans.
Somebody working in the restaurant, the kitchen, very good people working.
Do you like Trump, yes or no?
No.
You scared of Trump?
No.
sometimes it's crazy, sometimes it's good.
Are you afraid of Trump?
No.
Are you afraid of Trump?
Sí.
Why?
Lo que ha prometido que está haciendo deportaciones, cosas así.
I think that Trump is more of a celebrity and he's not politically fit.
Are people around here nervous about Trump's people kicking down doors and rounding people up?
Yes. Donald Trump like kind of jumped the ship. There are some criminals, but not everybody's an illegal alien. Some people's working all their life just to come to New York so they can have a better life. And I don't feel he should be able to judge who could come in and who can't.
Do you like Bill de Blasio, the mayor?
Yeah, then that is good. It's good guy.
No.
Oh, de Blasio is very good.
De Blasio bueno?
Sí, muy bueno.
Do you know who I am?
No.
I'm Waters, mi mundo.
Oh.
Still to come. Tucker Carlson's here, fresh off battling these basket cases all week. We ask him how he deals with these people. And up next, President Trump rocks CPAC.
It's time to stand up for America, to stand up for the American worker, and to stand up for the American flag.
It was all eyes on CPAC Friday morning as President Trump spoke to a standing room only crowd at the annual conservative conference.
There's never been anything like this. There's been some movements, but there's never been anything like this. There's been some movements that petered out, like Bernie, petered out. But it was a little rigged against him, you know, superdelegate. The core conviction of our movement is that we are a nation that put and will put its own citizens first.
We're building the wall. In fact, it's gonna start soon, way ahead of schedule.
And remember, we are getting the bad ones out. These are bad dudes. We're getting the bad ones out. And I said it from day one. Basically, all I've done is keep my promise.
I also attended CPAC this week, and while I was there, got some FaceTime with some of President Trump's inner circle. So, tell me the truth. Has the conservative movement and Donald Trump buried the hatchet?
Oh, look, I think conservatives at CPAC are energized and excited. I mean, we've got the opportunity to actually accomplish what we've been talking about for years. We've been given something really historic. Republican control of the White House, every federal agency, both houses of Congress. Now we got to deliver.
When are we going to see some action?
Well, look, I think we've seen action in the first month. I will commend the president for this first month. I think the cabinet nominations are very, very strong. It's an all-star cabinet. Judge Gorsuch for the Supreme Court is a strong, principled constitutionalist, exactly what President Trump promised the American people. And then I think the executive actions we've seen from the president have been bold and decisive.
The Democrats and media kind of scrambling for answers these days.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for them?
My advice to Democrats is set aside your anger and rage and ask yourself, what is it about your policies? What is it about the disaster that is Obamacare? What is it about crushing taxes and regulations that cause Democrats to lose voters who had voted Democrats for generations?
Kellyanne, the president's fake news attacks have been driving the press crazy. What do you think's going on right now with these guys in the media?
Well, the election of Donald Trump is something they neither anticipated, expected, nor wanted. And so there's been a real adjustment period. I think there's been the anger and grief and denial stages, and we're trying to get into the acceptance stages.
Do you think you'll ever get into the acceptance stage with the press?
Well, with some members of the press. I mean, I don't think it's a blanket statement, but he does see, the president sees false news reports daily, and he calls them out, saying, well, that's inaccurate or that's incomplete.
We are fighting the fake news. It's fake, phony, fake.
It's the incomplete coverage. It's all these great stories of his first month of action and impact that aren't being told. Part of it, too, is that this president is using Twitter and social media platforms at a clip, and so he's cutting out the middleman.
That's right, and the president's going to be telling some stories on Tuesday,
yes,
at the State of the
session.
Union. These addresses to the joint sessions are usually so boring. Can you please promise that the Trump address will not be boring?
Well, of course the Trump address won't be boring because Donald Trump's not boring.
Do you believe some of these fake news stories are designed because personally these members of the media dislike this president so much?
I think in some cases that's the case.
Really?
In some cases, I think they're just looking for clicks and they figure out how to make it the most sensational they can.
So you think it's about money?
I think there's a combination of motives. You know, we saw a story in the Washington Post a couple weeks ago that literally made up a scenario.
Mm-hmm.
And they wrote at the end of it, update. The White House denies it. And the story that came out in the Washington Post said that, you know, Steve Bannon had been over at the Department of Homeland Security. It was demonstrably false.
Mm-hmm.
And we could prove it. And instead of retracting it and issuing an apology, they put an update. The White House denies this. We didn't deny it. It was false. That just shows you that they have no interest in actually getting out the truth.
All right, just don't smash anybody with the podium.
What's that, dork?
I won't. The Thank super you. Soaker might come out, though.
Still to come, White Privilege Month at Pennsylvania College. Waters World was there to find out what that meant. Plus.
Wait 1 second, Mr. Carlson. Wait 1 second, okay? And yeah, there's a high-pitched laugh. I appreciate the high-pitched laugh. Anyway.
I appreciate your failing to give me an answer. What's the answer? Right.
We'll see what Tucker Carlson really thought of that interview and much more when we come right back. We are 5 weeks into President Trump's administration, and still, his critics cannot seem to accept the outcome of the election. They're always protesting and venting their anger on social media. So, many TV networks, including our own, have given them the opportunity to speak their minds. Like this protester who appeared on Tucker Carlson Tonight this week.
Actually, it would have taken millions and millions to rise up to stop Hitler. It absolutely would have.
But what do you
think?
And
it's what people should have done.
Okay, may I ask you a real question?
It is shameful for you to dismiss this.
But hold on, I know it's shameful. But let me ask you this.
It's funny to
your question. So the 60
No, because I know you love to carry water for this criminal, this war criminal wannabe in chief.
Tucker seems to attract all kind of kooks, kind of like myself. And the man is here to tell us how he processes these people. So, Tucker, it seems like if you want to call Trump Hitler, you go on your show. That's where you go to call Trump Hitler.
Well, I want to understand what's going on. I mean, the Trump is Hitler conversations are not that fruitful because there's nothing, you know, it's just a primal scream.
Yeah.
But I want to know why people are so agitated by Trump. I understand people would disagree with some of his views, and that's legitimate, obviously. I disagree with some of his views. But why the gut reaction of hysteria to this guy? Is it real? Is it a political tactic? And I want to get to the bottom of it. That woman did not help me get any closer.
I don't think she did. Because when they say Trump is Hitler, do they have anything to back that up? Or do they just say Hitler and think they made their point?
I think what they're really saying when they say Trump is Hitler, they're not saying just that he's evil, but they're saying I'm virtuous.
Mm.
This is a way in a post-Christian society for people to proclaim that they are good people. It used to be we'd say, I serve the poor, I go to church.
Right.
I believe in Jesus. I'm going to heaven when I die.
Right.
But now people say instead, you're evil, you're a racist, and I'm a good person.
Right. I'm not Hitler. That's
right.
The argument.
I'm not Hitler.
Now we also have one of our dear, dear friends, Eric Wemple from The Washington Post, going up against Tucker Carlson. Here you go.
Was
two.
It?
I
was it? Because here's the last
Here,
line,
wait,
and I'm
one
quoting.
Second. Wait 1 second, Mr. Carlson. Wait 1 second, okay? And there's a high-pitched laugh. I appreciate the high-pitched laugh. Anyway.
I appreciate your failing to give me an answer. What's the answer?
All right, there are few, if any, news organizations that allow their in-house media reporter to do as much coverage of their own shop as Fred Hyatt and Marty Baron allow me to do. And I'll cite you a few examples.
Then you just declined to do it?
So a guy with hair like that should not be criticizing anybody for having a high-pitched laugh. What was that even all about?
His newspaper routinely attacks others for being in the pocket of the Kremlin, puppets of Vladimir Putin, and yet they routinely and have for years run a propaganda section paid for and written by the Russian government, and that guy is supposed to be the media critic, has never even noted it. And so look, if you're going to be the fearless critic of American media, you ought to be willing to turn the lens on your own employer, but he's not. He sucks up to the people who pay his check
every week
and attacks everybody else from his moral perch. And I just thought I would ask him about it. He couldn't answer a single question.
No.
It was not a high-pitched laugh or not. It was not impressive.
He's a kind of a creepy guy. He always kind of like sidles up to me at places. Then he's like, oh, Jesse Waters. And I'm like, dude, get out of here, man. It's just like, you're boring
What
me.
Kind of parties do you go to where Eric Wemple is present?
It's actually CPAC.
Okay.
So there's that. Also, we have Falarca, this crazy protester. She's a teacher. She organized these anti-Milo protesters. You went head-to-head with her. Let's see what happened there.
If there was a student in your class who started espousing what you believe is fascism, and you said you need to leave, you need to be quiet, and he didn't leave, would you hit him as you hit that protester? Would you beat him up?
No, of course not. But that's
what
not what we're talking
not?
About
we
here.
Tape
we're talking about
someone.
People who, you know what? In Sacramento, there were fascists who had knives tied at the ends of sticks, and they stabbed people, including
us. Not the man
us.
That you hit.
Well, wait, first of all, do you believe there was, like, people with sticks with knives at the end of them poking people? Do you believe that was
Here's
actually true?
Here's what I know
true?
For a fact, so we had the video of it and played it.
Yeah.
So she went up to an unarmed man who she disagreed with and started punching him.
This little woman.
Yeah, so she's a fierce one.
Punch him in the face?
I gotta say. She wasn't tall enough to hit him in the face, but she kept it. But look, the point is, there's an authoritarian strain on the left. I think it's useful to speak to people like this because it illustrates it. They don't believe in free speech. They think that violence is a solution to political differences. And we ought to highlight this so at least the average person knows this is happening in this country. And it's not going to wind up in a good place at all.
When you hear someone say, I'm okay with violence, and they come on their show and they espouse that, do you know that they're going to say that beforehand? Or are you just kind of winging it and you just, I can't believe what these people are telling me? Because the look on your face during most of these interviews is priceless. It's like this shocked look of disbelief, like you can't understand what's actually coming out of their mouth.
I'm 47 years old. I didn't grow up in a country like this. I grew up in a country where people disagreed with each other, sometimes passionately, but they always acknowledged the other person's right to say what he thought.
Right.
And they always said, look, violence is a whole separate thing. Politics is a way to solve differences without violence. Things have changed so much, so fast on the left that I am bewildered by
it. You are bewildered?
I am.
It looks like you're bewildered. You're definitely showing that emotion.
Yeah.
Also, graduate student and writer at NYU went at you for some sort of riot they had against a conservative in Manhattan. Let's look at this.
So if I were to go to a rally and people said, I'm just pulling this out of thin air, pigs in a blanket fry like bacon. About police officers advocating the killing of cops. I mean, you would say that's unacceptable. That should not be allowed. Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying if student group wants to have a discussion about police brutality
if they were to use that phrase, pigs in a blanket, fry like bacon.
I'm not interested in the phrase. I'm not going to debate you over this phrase should be allowed
because
or not.
Because you have no principles. That's why. Because all the things you've been saying for the last 11 minutes are totally untrue.
Tucker, that was so mean to say that he had no principles. You were a mean person.
Well, he was just going on about how some guy he disagrees with, Gavin McGinnis, who's actually a very smart guy and a good guy, is a fascist and a danger to our society, and his words inspire violence, really? So I said the obvious point, which is you have people in the street advocating for killing of cops. What do you make of that?
Right.
And because he has no principles, he couldn't respond. And by the way, he's a student. How old can you be and be a student?
And he wasn't even
wearing... student racket is a good one.
I know. This is why people stay in school for so long. Tucker, thank you very much.
Jesse Waters, ladies and gentlemen.
Good luck next
Great
week
to see
with
you.
These kooks.
Thank you.
Next, the Republican Party finally united under President Trump. I get the answers from some of the leading conservatives at CPAC. And next... I quiz students at one school where white privilege has become a hot topic on campus.
Do you believe white privilege exists in this country?
Yeah.
Then how did Obama become president?
Fox News Channel on Sirius XM, your favorite shows on channel 114. Plus every story, every 15 minutes, Fox News headlines 24/7, channel 115.
Slim Shady, yes, I'm the real Shady. All you other Slim Shadys are just imitating. So won't the real Slim Shady please stand up? Please stand up. Please stand up.
Paper, pencils, and privilege? That's right. Democratic student leaders at Elizabethtown College in Pennsylvania have asked their peers and professors to wear white puzzle pins to bring attention to white privilege. We wondered if their campaign would just cause more division among the races instead of bringing people together. So Waters World traveled to central Pennsylvania to see what it was all about. Why are you wearing a white privilege button?
Because I'm acknowledging that I have white privilege because my skin tone is white.
You look a little
flush, though, not completely white.
Yeah, because I'm embarrassed to be talking to Fox News.
What is white privilege?
I don't know if I'm qualified to answer that question.
You're white. White privilege month here at school. How do you guys feel about that?
Nobody really cares.
Yeah.
White privilege is a myth.
White privilege month. Don't you guys think you're taking away from Black History Month?
That's an interesting question.
I don't feel like I would be turned down from a job or anything like that because of my skin color.
So. I'd turn you down for your hair.
It's blue!
How does it feel to have white privilege?
Well, I think being white, I don't necessarily feel it. I think it's something that other people are noticing and...
Wait. You don't know that you're white?
You mean I'm not white?
Oh yeah, no, I know I'm white.
Maybe they might look at me and maybe if I dress a certain way, it might look like I'm a thug or something.
Oh, because you have a hoodie.
Or something.
Oh, wait.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, I might look like a bad guy or...
If you could change your race, would you do that?
No, because then that would change who I am fundamentally.
So you like your white privilege?
That's a good one. That's a double-sided one.
So do you believe white privilege exists in this country?
Yeah.
Then how did Obama become president?
It is easier in America to be white, but I do not believe in white privilege.
Is it easier to be white on the dance floor?
I mean, I can't dance to save my life. I trip over patterns in the carpet.
Fancy
emojis. Do you feel guilty about your white privilege?
Sometimes, but it's just a part of me. I wouldn't change the fact that I'm white. Race is a social construct.
So you're not white?
I am Italian. I'm American.
So isn't it more determinative to have American privilege than have white privilege?
Okay, I'm gonna stop now.
All right, we were doing so well, I thought. Joining me now with his take on all this is deputy editor of The Daily Caller, as well as the author of the brand new book, No Campus for White Men, Scott Greer. So I talked to all these college students, and I still don't even understand what white privilege is. Can you please explain it to me?
Well, white privilege is a term that they use for all Caucasians living in America and other Western countries have these inherent social privileges, such as they can walk into a mall and security won't be eyeing them, that they...
Wait, well, why won't security eye me when I walk into a mall?
Because they apparently, according to the theory, is that mall security only targets minorities. They give more attention, and apparently that hurts their lives.
Okay.
So they say that whites benefit this. They call it an invisible knapsack that we all carry around, and we get all this privilege. It's these social privileges. You really can't legislate it about policy, and I don't know how wearing puzzle pins is going to change anything about it. I mean, it's just making you look silly.
Yeah, I don't know. And when you put the puzzle pieces all together, I don't know what that's supposed to
It's too much white privilege for anyone to handle.
No, so assuming that there is a little white privilege, let's just take that for granted. What am I supposed to feel? Guilty about that?
Yeah, I think that's
supposed to feel guilty.
That's what they want you to feel guilty. I mean, the whole purpose at Elizabethtown is like we're putting these puzzle pins on just to show our shame for having white privilege,
Oh.
even though it's something that you didn't even have any course over. We didn't determine our color or skin or birth. You know, we didn't check it off. It's like, yeah, I want to be white to have all this privilege.
I didn't pay for white privilege.
It's something that you have no control over, yet people are supposed to be feeling guilty about it.
So, if you feel guilty about your white privilege, what are you supposed to do about it? What can I do?
Well, as the example is, just feel bad about it. I outlined in my book.
So it's just about feeling bad.
Yeah, I outlined in my book, No Campus for White Men, all the examples of like how it's just about making white people kind of feel bad for all these privileges. And now we even have Hillary Clinton last year in her campaigning on, I do have white privilege, which is, well, what are we supposed to do about that?
You know, I think white privilege does exist, but there's no white privilege on the basketball court because when I play, I can't jump. All I can do is shoot. I mean, I'm a mess out there. So I don't think it's an across-the-board thing.
No, it's not. I mean, everybody in life has certain difficulties that they have to overcome.
Especially
and some people have benefits or advantages that other people don't have.
Right.
And just reducing it to a racial thing just creates more division and doesn't ease race relations. It just makes them worse. So I think it's almost keeping things around that we shouldn't have.
That's true. Well, I mean, there's handsome privilege. There's tall privilege. I think everyone's privileged in one way or the other, but I don't feel that guilty about it, I have to say. Thank you very much, Scott. I really appreciate
it. Thank you.
Up next, big uproar earlier this week after Milo Yiannopoulos was booted from CPAC. What was his reaction?
CPAC gave Milo the boot. Good idea or bad idea?
Oh, I think it was definitely a good idea, sweet Lord Almighty. I mean, come on! What were you thinking?
Plus, your tweets of the week and a special announcement you do not want to miss. President Donald Trump's absence at last year's CPAC raised questions about conservative unity and what that would mean at this year's convention. Well, this year he headlined it. But the bigger headline from CPAC earlier in the week had become the last-minute cancellation of firebrand Milo Yiannopoulos after videos surfaced showing Milo appearing to defend pedophilia. He since apologized for that, but it wasn't enough. But I was there with reaction to Milo and everything else. What's the vibe right now here at CPAC?
Lots of young people. It's exciting. People are happy that there's winning going on. So much winning. They're not sick of it yet.
This is like the Super Bowl for conservatives.
If it's the Super Bowl, hopefully Janet Jackson doesn't reveal anything here. It's Janet. Miss Jackson, if you missed. Are conservatives united right now, do you think?
I think the more crazy the left gets, it's hard not to be united.
No. If you think back to a year ago at this very conference, Donald Trump didn't show up because he was afraid of the response of the conservative movement. This year, now apparently he's their hero.
Fake news dominating. Do you feel sorry for the press at all?
No.
They're whining.
They did it to themselves.
They did it to
themselves. Except Fox News.
Trump has a very loose relationship with the truth a lot of the time. And so the media is, it's incumbent on us, I think, to hold him accountable and tell the truth. But I think so many folks in the mainstream press in particular are so reflexively hostile to him, they are willing to believe the worst things about him and rush that to the air, rush it to print without checking twice and three times, and in fact putting out fake news, which allows, just like sets up Trump for the volleyball spike right in their faces.
CPAC gave Milo the boot. Good idea or bad idea?
Oh, I think it was definitely a good idea, sweet Lord Almighty. I mean, come on! What were you thinking?
He messed up in a big way. You know, he said he's a wild man, and I love him, but when you're a wild man, you do go off the deep end.
Do you like wild men?
Yes.
In politics?
Yes.
Why do you think CPAC booked Milo to begin with?
I think it's because we can work together on the free speech issue. I think that's something that's a hot button issue within the conservative movement right now. But should he have ever been headlining a conservative event? I don't think so.
Can Milo recover from this week? Yes or no?
It depends on what you mean by recover. Do I think eventually someone's going to publish his book? Yeah. Do I think it'll sell a good number of copies? Probably. The idea that he's going to be back in sort of the mainstream bloodstream of conservatism anytime soon, I am more dubious of that.
Always remember one thing. I'm Waters, and this is my world.
It sure is.
Thank you. Stay tuned. Viewer tweets of the week when we come right back. It's time to hear from the people. Today, Matt Jelinski writes, Waters World is one of the greatest things to ever exist. Can't argue with that. James Elder says, you are the most stupidest person. You need to be a toll collector on the parkway. And you need a grammar lesson. Jeb and Corey tweet, Jesse, Corey and I can't decide if you're funny and smart or if the morons you interview just make you look like you are. I think it is a little bit of both. And CP says, I thoroughly enjoy your show, but as a warmer weather approaches, can you chill with the popping of your collars? I just can't support it. Actually, I cannot chill with that. And as a matter of fact, viewer warning, I'm going to be at the Daytona 500 this weekend and the O'Reilly Factor on Monday night. Waters World's collar will be popped. So be sure to send me your thoughts on the show. Your comments may end up on our air. You can reach me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And before we go, I just want to let you know that we have a very big interview in store for you for next week's show. Trust me, you do not want to miss it. Huge. And with that, show's over. Justice with Judge Jeanine is up next. And always remember, I'm Waters, and this is my world.